Right present in the chat. Start writing present, ma'am, in the chat, all of you. Yeah, all of you, please write present. Again and again, I have to remind you, those who are entering just now, please type message. Only those who type the message present will be marked present in the register later on. So please. I hope all of you have typed. In 1 minute, I'm going to log the session. Okay, so all the new joinees have written present, ma'am. Those who have come just now, those who have not typed, please type, and I'm going to start the session and I'll log the session now. Okay, let's start. Yesterday we were on this revenue, what is income, what is profit, what is gain. And I have already explained this, what is the difference between revenue, income, profit and gain. So we move to losses now. What are losses? Generally you know what is the loss. When you spend more and you receive less on that particular object or item or product, that difference is loss in your general terms. But in business terms, let's see what is loss. Loss means there are two types, two meanings. First, it conveys the result of business for a period when total expenses exceed the total revenues. When total revenues, it can be related with the sales of your products, or it can be related with some interest received or commission received or discount received or sale of any fixed asset, all the incomes. And when you find the difference between all the incomes, that is all the revenues and all the expenses, if expenses are more, then that is loss. Or in the formula, when the answer comes in negative, it will be a loss. Secondly, it refers to some facts or activities against which firm receives no benefit. Sometimes you don't have any gain to receive against an activities. Like examples are given. There may be a fire in your godown or in your office or at the factory place. So many things may destroy in the fire. So that loss will be another type of loss. Generally, we call such losses as abnormal losses. Theft, if there is a theft, if there is any accident and some fixed assets are destroyed or some current assets are destroyed. Maybe like suppose there was a road accident and the vehicle was destroyed. Suppose there was a theft in the office, cash was stolen. So that can be also another loss. So there are two types of losses. Like in a normal course of business, like selling and buying goods, and another way to receive the revenues and spend the expenses. And when you find the differences, that difference is also a loss. Another, natural activities like loss due to fire or loss due to theft or an accident. Such losses are also, and they are known as abnormal losses. Now purchases. This purchases and sales I have already explained you on in the first slide of the chapter, but still I'll just read out. The term is used for buying of goods for resale in case of a trading concern, or acquiring of raw material to use them in manufacturing process in the case of manufacturing concern. It includes both cash and credit purchase of the goods. Now there can be two types of business you are conducting. Suppose one is directly you are selling the already finished goods. As I told you, one example of like say books, you are buying the books from wholesaler and selling it to the customers. So there you don't have to produce anything. You are just buying and selling. So that is a trading concern. So the goods, I mean the books which you are buying for reselling, such books, such goods are here. The process of that buying those goods or commodities, products is known as purchase. And in second type of business, you make yourself the goods. Suppose you are not buying the goods, you are printing yourself, you are binding them, and you are a publisher yourself, or say the book manufacturer yourself. Then you need paper, glues, binding machine, typing machine, Xerox machine, many things. Then all the materials which you need to make these books, those materials are considered as goods. And when you buy them, that activity is considered as purchase. Same thing for sales. Now, when you have that stock, goods or books, for example, and you are going to sell it to the customers, the amount which you receive against, or the value of books which you are selling to the customer, that value, total value, will be considered as the sales. So it refers the amount of sale or goods, sale of goods or services rendered. It seems transfer of ownership of goods and services to the customer for a price. That means you are transferring your ownership to the customer in the return of price. You are getting money. And till now, the books were belonging to you, but now they are belonging to the customer. That means you're transferring your ownership to the customers in return of the price of that product. The term sale is used only for the sales of those goods which are purchased for resale purposes. It is never used for the sale of assets. So this sale word and purchase word both will be used only for the buying and selling of the goods, products which you are going to manufacture and which are meant to resell them to the third party or the party. Only then we can call them as purchase or sales. But when you buy fixed assets like building and machine or land, then you don't use this word purchase. Then directly you write building or directly you write machine. The account name you have to open later on, will come to the numerical part. Then you'll understand that why we are using this purchase and sales only for the raw materials or the goods we are buying to, which are meant to resell. Okay, moving to next. Now this is stock or inventory. Now what is stock or what is inventories? Like suppose you have both type of, as I explained you, that manufacturing or trading business. So if it is a trading business and you have bought the books and you have bought in large number and you are not able to sell these goods, maybe you have bought say 1,000 books and till the end of the day you just sold 800 copies. So the 200 lying are your stock at the end of the year, or we call it as closing stock. So the goods or the products which are still lying unsold in our business, which are kept somewhere, maybe in godown or you have a particular place, but in short, which are not yet sold are called stock. Same thing, it can be for raw materials. So if you are manufacturing company and if you have bought, suppose you have bought many papers to print and those papers are not being used. So those materials which are lying, some glues are there which are not being used. So such materials will be considered as stock. Now I'm reading it. It includes the value of those goods which are lying unsold. unsold at the end of accounting period. Stock may be of two types, opening stock and closing stock. So which I told you that the end of the year, whatever is lying, it is your closing stock. But again, on the first day of the financial year, same closing stock becomes opening stock. Just a minute, I think someone wants to enter. Okay, I'm going back. So closing stock, which was lying at the end of the year, and generally our financial year we follow, I'll explain next chapter regarding concepts in that. I'll explain what is accounting year. Accounting year generally what we follow is 31st March, means last day is 31st March and first day will be your 1st April. So the goods, number of goods or the value of the goods, whatever is there on 31st March will be considered as closing stock. And same amount next day on 1st April, it will be considered as opening stock. So opening stock means the value of goods lying unsold at the beginning of accounting period, whereas closing stock means the value of goods lying unsold at the end of accounting period. Now what are debtors? I have explained you these debtors. Debtors are those people firm to whom the goods have been sold or services have been rendered on credit and payment has not been received from them. They still owe some amount to the business. So the customers to whom, or the people or the firm, it's not only one person will come and ask, maybe one person can also be your customer. Sometimes it can be a firm itself, one firm buying from another firm. Now what is this firm? Firm means business entity, business unit, enterprise. So we call it as firm. When it is a sole proprietorship, we call it as firm, a business unit. So when a person or maybe a business unit buying goods from us or from the supplier and they are not paying the amount in cash with the condition that they'll pay the amount later on, so such people or such firms are considered as debtors. Same thing for creditors. Those persons or firms from whom goods have been purchased or services procured on credit and payment has not been yet made to them are called creditors. Now, being a firm, we being a firm, when we buy goods or when we purchase goods or we use the services of some other firm, then such, and that too not paying the amount in cash and paying it on a future date, then those people or those firm for us are considered as creditors. That means we owe someone to pay in future. That's the reason we consider creditors as our liability and debtors as our asset. Some amount is still owing to them. Now what is a voucher? Voucher, in just now before this reading the definition, I'll let you know that whenever there is any event or any transaction taking place, economical transaction, as in the first slide I explained you that which type of transactions the accountant has to select or to identify. So those are business activity and those should be having an economic value or financial value. So any activity, any transaction taking place in the business, such activity should be always supported or should have always the evidence. So those receipts, you must have seen many times when you go, not as a business entity, but as a customer, when you go to a shop, to say malls, whenever you buy any garments, any of the item, whenever you buy it, you pay some amount against that product. But you always get a receipt supporting the transaction that you have paid the amount paid or amount received. They'll stamp it and they'll give you. So such receipts, which acts as a proof, which acts as an evidence for the particular transaction, are considered as a voucher. And if there is no voucher against any transaction, you are not supposed to enter that transaction in the books of accounts. Just writing, suppose you have bought the goods of 20,000 and you are writing it in the journal, first book, primary book, that on 21st of April, books bought of this many, and you don't have any voucher, you don't have any receipt supporting this transaction, then it is useless. It's not to be considered that this transaction took place. So now what is a voucher? Voucher is a document which provides the authorization to pay and on the basis of which the business transactions are first of all recorded in the books of accounts. They are prepared by accountant and each voucher is numbered and countersigned by the authorized person of the firm. Whenever the accountant is entering the voucher, he will just number it according to the entries. I told you chronological and way we are going to present in the books according to the date, year, month, and same way the accountant is also going to put the vouchers in same order along with a countersigned by the authorized person of the firm. Next, discount. You are very much familiar with the word discount, I guess. So in short, discount generally you mean that whenever you go and buy something at a lower rate compared to what was the actual rate, that difference is known as discount. That means any reduction in the price of any product while buying or selling is the discount. So here it is written as it is a rebate or an allowance given by the seller to the buyer. And you can also write in this way that any reduction in the value of the price of a product by a seller to the buyer is called discount. I'll repeat. It may be in the book also. So I'm again repeating. Any reduction in the value of a price of any commodity given by the seller to the buyer is known as discount. There are two types of discounts: cash discount and trade discount. I'll just go through whether I'll explain you what is cash discount and trade discount. Now, first comes trade discount, then comes cash discount. Now, trade discount means it is generally given on the bulk amount of purchases and generally given by the wholesaler or when you buy it directly from the factory outlet for the business purpose to resell them, then that discount is considered as trade discount. So being a firm, when I go and buy it from other suppliers, suppose I am buying the books of list price of say 2 lakhs and because I am buying it in a bulk amount, in a lump sum amount, the seller is ready to give me 5% discount on this 2 lakhs. So I am getting 10,000 of reduction in the value of goods. So I am going to pay only 1,90,000. So this 10,000 which I have got directly from the wholesaler is your trade discount. And this trade discount is nowhere shown when we enter in the primary books in journal. You will write directly the purchases you will write and you will write directly 1,90,000. You will not show that 1,90,000 plus 10 and the total purchases and this much maybe cash or credit was of 2 lakhs. List price is 2 lakhs. But you don't take least price. You take the amount which you receive after deducting this trade discount. So for you, the cost of books will be 1,90,000, not the 2 lakh. Then what is cash discount? Cash discount is meant which attracts the customer to pay the amount as soon as possible. Or we call it as prompt payment. Suppose as a business firm, I'm selling the goods to the customer. I sold to a small shopkeeper, say of 10,000, and he is asking on credit. He is asking that he wants the books on credit. So what we say, that we say if you are going to pay the amount just now, I'm going to give you 5% discount. Or suppose he has asked that he is going to pay the amount after 3 months. So again, you can attract the customer to pay the amount before the due date. Like you say that if you pay within 15 days, or if you, instead of paying in 3 months, if you pay me the amount in 1 month, I'll give you 5% discount. So this discount, which is attracting the customers or the buyers to make a prompt payment, is your cash discount. And this cash discount is always shown in the, always recorded in the books. You will be having a difference, which I'll give you, or maybe you have it later on, I'll give the difference between what is trade discount and cash discount. So first point is that trade discount is generally on a bulk amount, large quantities, and cash discount is generally on the minor amounts. Then first is for trade discount, second is it is generally given by the wholesaler to the retailer. And cash discount is generally, it is given to the customers by the entity, business entity. Third one is trade discount is not recorded in the books of account, and cash discount is recorded in the books of account. I'll go to the other topic. Differences, more of the differences, two more differences we have that we'll discuss later on. Okay. Purchases already I have explained you. Still, I'll just read out from the T.S. Grewal. This I have taken the screenshot. Purchase is used for the account to record the purchase of goods or raw material for resale or for producing the products which are to be sold. The term purchases includes both cash and credit purchases. Goods purchased for cash are termed as cash purchases, and goods purchased on credit are termed as credit purchases. Then you have purchase returns. Purchase returns, the meaning itself shows you that whatever you have bought, and if you wish a certain amount of goods to be returned back due to some reason, maybe defective, or maybe there must be a deal that if I can sell this many, and if unsold goods are left, you have to take it back, or there are many, many situations when you have to return the goods. So when the amount of the goods which you are returning out of the purchase, out of the amount of purchases, that amount of goods are considered as purchase returns. Then sales is associated with or used for sale of goods. These goods may be purchased for resale or manufactured by the enterprise. The term sales includes both cash and credit. Same thing, if you are selling it on cash, it is your cash sales. If you are selling it on credit, it is credit sales. Again, you have sales return. As you can return your goods to supplier, the customers can also return the goods to you. So that please mute your voice. Okay, so sales return means goods when returned by the purchaser are termed as sales return or sales inward. You have another name of sales return, that is sales return inward, and in purchase also you have purchase outward, but return outward. Outward means some goods are going outside. When the goods will go outside? When you must have purchased something and you are returning back, that is return outward. And these are return inward. When will the goods come back? When you must have sold. So it is return inward. Both the names are applicable. Goods. Now what are goods? Goods are the physical items of trade that are purchased to be sold. Now it can be raw material or it can be the finished material. I told you the products or the commodities which you are buying. In trading, it will be directly the finished good. And in manufacturing, it will be the raw materials which will be helping you to produce or manufacture that particular product. The term applies to all the items making up the sales or purchases of the business. Stating differently, they are the stock in trade of an enterprise purchased or manufactured with the purpose of selling. For an enterprise dealing in the home appliances such as TV, fridge, etc. are the goods. And for stationery is the good. This closing stock, opening stock already I have explained you. Trade receivables. Now what are trade receivables? Before that, I'll explain you this. I have explained this debtors, Debtors are the people entity who owe to the enterprise against the goods purchased from the enterprise on credit. So those people are considered as debtors. And now what happens, I have explained you this bills receivable also. They sign a written document which shows it's a conditional order and it is a promise maybe by the debtor to the creditor that I'm going to pay the amount in 3 months, 4 months, 1 month, whatever the condition may be. So that written document is considered as bills receivable. And some debtors, they don't have any written proof. It is only the word of promise. And in business world, you many times you have to trust the words of the customer or maybe the supplier has to trust the on our promises. So there is no written document. So such people who has bought the goods from us without any written agreement, as well as those people who have given us the agreement with the signature and all the details. So together, this both of them are obviously the people who have got the goods from us on credit. So together, debtors and bills receivable, we call it as trade receivables. So both the terms, when we speak together, debtors and bills receivable, it is considered as trade receivables. Same thing for trade payables. Now we also may buy goods on credit. And sometimes we don't, we only a oral promise is okay, but sometimes you need a written promise. So again, those who are only relying on, who are believing us, trusting us on the oral promise, our creditors, and the bills payable to whom we have given a written promise agreement is bills payable. So together, creditors and bills payable, together we call it as trade payables. This trade payables and this trade receivable together will be used in 12th standard. Just now you are only concerned with the individual terms, that is creditor and bills payable, debtors and bills receivable. Now another, this credit and debit. You must have heard many times that accounts means only debit credit from the seniors. Now actually, what is this credit and debit? When you have a table, when I call it as an account, and or I just now you just think that it is a table which has two parts. One is left hand side, another is right hand. When you partition a page, suppose when in when you were younger in lower classes, differences were asked. Maybe in science or maybe in SS, you used to draw a line in between the page. You used to partition the page in two halves, two columns. One side was left side, one side was right hand side. So same thing we do. We make a partition and the left hand side is considered as a debit and right hand side is considered as the credit. So just I'm reading it. Credit is the right side of an account. If an account is to be credited, then the entry is to be posted on the credit side. Suppose like rules, you are going to learn it in the third chapter. If we say that, okay, go and debit the purchase, then you have to go to the purchase side, purchase account, and you have to write it on the debit side. Or if I say that sales are to be credited. So what we do, we make a sales account and we go on the credit side and we write the amount. So the sentence, whatever the sentence may be, you have to follow that. So if an account is to be credited, then the entry is to be posted on the credit side of the account. And if the account says that it's to be debited, then we go and post the entry on the debit side. In such an event, it is said that the account is credited and it has been derived from an Italian word called credito or debito. And the initials, short forms we write, we don't write full sentence. We just write DR and CR. So CR on the corner of the account, of the column, we can say on the debit side, left hand side, we'll write DR and on the right hand side, we'll write CR. What is entity? Entity, as I have been using since beginning. Entity means it is a business unit or you can say it is an enterprise or a firm. So any business entity. An entity means an economic unit which performs economic activities. Examples are given Reliance, Bajaj Auto, Maruti, Tisco. These are all companies, but still entity, enterprises, under that you have all the three forms of business organization, that is sole proprietorship, partnership and company. But in 11th standard, we are studying only sole proprietorship. So for us, just now, an individual unit of an individual person is your economic unit or an entity. A business entity means an enterprise established in accordance with law to engage in business activities. This includes proprietorship firms, partnership firms, corporations, companies, etc. An accounting system is always devised for a specific business entity, also called accounting entity. So there are different names which we'll be using: financial entity, financial unit, only entity, accounting entity, enterprise. So that all results means there is a business unit. The common name you can say is a business unit. So this is done for today, and maybe the chapter is also done. First chapter is done, which was helping you to know the terms of the accounts, first of all. One more chapter is there, which is your theory chapter. And then after that, we are going to do only numericals in account, only practical questions. So one more chapter you have to bear with the theory. But I hope this is also interesting for you. And I hope you will start completing your worksheet, all the terms I have explained you. And today I may give you one more screenshot from that, like one liner or objective questions are there, which you can write in your notebook. You have to write in your notebook. See you tomorrow same time. Any doubt, children? You can raise your hand if you have doubt. Okay, one per boy has asked me, is there a difference between voucher and token amount? Jay, you have asked me that, is there any difference between voucher and a token amount? See, this token amount is totally different. We don't have this token amount just now in your syllabus.